pretty much as funny as my talk will get the whole night. The other day, I was lip-syncing to Barbra Streisand. The way you do when you're a 55-year-old white gay male in London, Ontario. And thought about what it means to feel out of sync. When a border guard asks me what I do, I say teacher, because it's awkward and not a little pompous to say professor of English literature or director of the School of Advanced Studies in the Arts and Humanities, or where I'm off my research interests, which include romantic literature, 18th and 19th century philosophy, psychiatry, psychoanalysis, pop culture, film musicals, and I already hear your eyes glazing over, which is why I do that list. As a product of the working class, I have an ambivalent relation to my accomplishments. I walked out on a master's degree in English literature to start a business. All that complexity and interpretation made me feel useless. My mother cried, "I had such hopes for you." Although when I gave up business to return to school, she said, "You're giving up all that money." I know now it's okay, maybe, to have both, but my mother also warned me, "You think too much." What terror was she protecting me from when she said that? Why is advisory alert against contemplation without the urgent demand to make sense? Put another way, why is it dangerous or pointless to educate hearts and minds as well as hearts and souls as well as minds and bodies? Why is distrust of deep, often disruptive thought against educating imaginations and curiosity, empathy, curation, engagement, translation, creativity, things that come with picking up books, pens, brushes, violins, cameras, instead of guns? To tell our stories and the stories of others, to remain capable, this is where it gets geeky, really geeky, to remain capable of being in uncertainties, mysteries, and doubts without any irritable reaching after fact and reason. That's the romantic poet John Keats in 1817. In 1859, Matthew Arnold said poets like Keats were premature. Like Hamlet, they thought too much and didn't do enough. Creativity should lead to critical action, but even Arnold might be wearied by our world of metrics and tireless innovation for innovation's sake. Here's Shelley in his 1821 Defensive Poetry. "We have more moral, political, and historical wisdom than we know how to reduce into practice, more scientific and economical knowledge than can be accommodated to the just distribution of the produce which it multiplies. The poetry and the existence of thought is concealed by the accumulation of facts and calculating processes. We want the creative faculty to imagine that which we know. We want the generous impulse to act that which we imagine. We want the poetry of life." Here's Thomas de Quincey in 1845. "Among the powers in man which suffer by this too intense life of the social instinct, none suffers more than the power of dreaming." Now, he was an opium addict, so take it for what it's worth. Remember that Plato banished the poets from society for dreaming. Here's W.H. Auden in 1939, and I apologize, these are all dead white guys, I know. Poetry makes nothing happen. It survives in the valley of its fame, where executives would never want to tamper. It flows out from ranches of isolation and the busy Greeks, raw towns that we believe and die in. It survives. A way of happening, a mouth. It's not that poetry is useless, it's that it speaks otherwise. It survives creatively. So here's my question. Are we pushing ourselves too hard? Creative failure is a catchphrase that means we need to turn on the pivot of failure as quickly as possible. But I'm mindful of Samuel Beckett. Try again, fail better. Maybe not such a good idea for a recruitment poster. But let's not forget that the failures of political imagination that routinely and rather uncreatively wastes public money on a daily basis. Would it be so bad to promote poetry or mere contemplation as essential forms of education as a necessary squandering of creativity? In our student spaces, I see a fearless capacity to tackle the future. We design entire educational and professional systems to help them do so. We ask them to work as hard as possible to advance as quickly as possible across the horizons of their futures, and we ask them to map out that horizon on our behalf. But as William Blake writes, the failure can unfold, the future can unfold, pardon me, a perilous path. at the moment. What might happen to climate change, to the unrestrained exploiting of limited natural resources, growing socioeconomic disparity, to religious, political, sexual, and cultural intolerance against things we don't, can't, or won't try to understand? And what about the neglect of the everyday aspect of lives of our spirits and those of others? The stories of how we feel. Thought and creativity wastes a lot of time and energy. I'm a testament to that. But to imagine that which we know is that the human spirit does not get buried in facts or blinded by progress, how could that possibly be a bad thing? To momentarily disengage from the world while remaining alert to those who might exploit this disconnect. Would a little more productive, creative waste actually kill us? Here's what I know. Here's a poem whose aim is true without taking a life. This is for the staff students. This is for all students. This is for the students that we all are. This is the poet, Polish poet, Czesław Miłosz. Faith is in you whenever you look at a dewdrop or a floating leaf and know that they are because they have to be. Even if you close your eyes and dream up things, the world will remain as it has always been, and the leaf will be carried by the waters of the river. You have faith also when you hurt your foot against a sharp rock, and you know that rocks are here to hurt our feet. See the long shadow that is cast by the tree? We and the flowers throw shadows on the earth. What has no shadow has no